Okay.
Hello, hello. Welcome to Elite Week. I hope you guys are ready for a party because we're going to rock out. All right, let's get through the sound checks. With me tonight, we've got Roy. Say hi, Roy.
Happy Friday, everyone. Glad you're here. Tell me how I sound.
Right on. Yes, yes. Let's hear how he sounds. And we also have Tweaked. Say hi, Tweaked.
Happy Friday night, everybody. We are back.
Yes, 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 yes. Welcome, welcome. And we've got Wolf Dragon. Say hi, Wolf.
Hello, everyone.
Yes, yes. That was a swordsmith impersonation with you banging on the desk at first, and then you said hi. Right on. Okay. Everybody's sound is good, I hope. Please let us know. The Restream bot. We got shit working tonight. All right, so on YouTube, I want to make sure that I call out and say hello, hello to Spike553. Tokoso made that pick. Ask him, right? Load 200, Winter Mute, Anthony Scaletti. Scaletti. We got Tweaked, Big C, Nomad. Let's see here. That's the people on the YouTubes, on the YubTubs to start off with. On the Twitch, who we got? We got Wolf Dragon. We've got Roy. We've got Nomadic Data. I was looking for Nomad. I'm like, what? Okay, yeah, Nomadic Data. We've got, let's see here, Shorty Mojo XTFN1. Hello, hello. Mark Xanthius. I dig that name. Lots and lots of people. We have got a bunch of stuff to get to tonight, so we are just going to hit it fast. So we're going to get it started. Let's see here.
Mm-hmm.
your side. You've been running, hiding much too long. No, it's just your foolish pride. Layla, got me on my knees. Layla, got me begging, please. Layla, darling, won't you ease my bloodline? Got me begging, please. Layla, trying to give you consolation.
Hello, hello, and welcome to Elite Week. This is episode 72, Alpha Phase 3, Space Cowboys, Galactic Water Cooler, Friday, April 16th, 2021. Hello, hello, and welcome. I am your host, Kai Zen, and tonight I am drinking some margaritas with some Hornita Salsa Blanca tequila, and also some Dragon's Milk, because I am dual wielding. So, yeah. All right. With me is Roy Cookson. Say hello to the beautiful people, Roy. And what are you drinking tonight?
Happy Friday, everyone. Glad you're with us. Tonight I'm having a glass of Old Soul, Old Vine Zinfandel, one of my favorites. It's 3 out of 9 on wine.com. 3.9 out of 5, rather, on wine.com. And it only costs $10.
All right. We've also got Tweak 74. How you doing, brother? And what you drinking?
Friday night, once again, we have some things to talk about this week.
Oh,
yeah. I'm drinking coffee because, well, I'm getting old, and it's been a shitastic week, and I need it to keep me going.
I got you, brother. I got you. Sometimes you got to stay awake. We also have Wolf Dragon. Wolf, how you doing, and what you drinking?
Oh, I'm doing well on this fine Friday evening, and I'm drinking Bitburger.
Right on. Beep, beep. We're going to start this off with an edit right from the very beginning. Motahive, edit this part out. The song was not coming through clearly for people, or was in the chat? Can I hear from people? Were you hearing the song clearly, or was it bad? Because we're going to be making some changes as we go along here. I am the actual tech guy tonight, so Lord Jesus help us. Let's see. The song was clear in the channel and poppy in the Discord. Okay, well, so long as it was clear in the channel, just turn Discord down or turn me down, mute me during the song, whatever you need to do. But so long as it was clear on the chat, like the people that were listening on YouTube and Twitch heard it fine, I'm good with that. I'm not seeing anybody responding. Maybe it's because of the delay.
They are on YouTube. YouTube, they're saying the song came through just fine.
Okay, beautiful. So we're going to, yeah, just the people in Discord will have to get used to that, and it is what it is. And Monohive, you can edit back in. Beep, beep. All right. So, yes, yes, yes. Welcome, welcome. We've got a lot to talk about tonight, so let's get right to it. from the very beginning, let's call out the cover art on here. Did you hear something? By Toko So. Toko So made an awesome picture. He made some phenomenal art there. Our opening song is If Stevie Wonder Wrote Layla by Scary Pockets. Our closing song is going to be The Joker. And that's a shout out to all the space cowboys out there in the galaxy just getting murked. People running around on airless moons in cowboy hats for some reason, because science doesn't fucking matter. All right. So, we want to give a huge welcome back to Sally Morgan Moore to the Elite Community team, specifically to Frontier, and now she's on the Elite Community Manager team. Phase 3 began yesterday, April 15th? And there's a lot to pick apart there, and a lot for us to get to. And as I said, we've got a galaxy full of space cowboys. All this and more, so stay tuned.
If you're listening to us on the podcast and would like to see the live show and visuals, check us out on YouTube at youtube.com/EliteWeek and on Twitch at twitch.tv/EliteWeek. If you're watching us on YouTube or Twitch and would like to know how to catch us on our podcast, check out anchor.fm/EliteWeek.
For sending us your thoughts by email, you can reach us at EliteWeek3306@gmail.com.
Our very active and growing Elite Week Discord can be found at tinyurl.com/EliteWeekDiscord, where you can check out or contribute to community feedback, resources on turning the wheel, and real-time updates about Elite from a variety of content creators.
In addition to the Discord community feedback channel, feel free to write in our YouTube comments anything about the topic of the week, as well as anything else you'd like to share. We'd love to hear from you. Also, if you're enjoying the show on YouTube, please make sure to like and subscribe and click on the bell. It really helps us out. On Twitch, a follow would be much appreciated.
If you're on Twitter, feel free to follow at EliteWeek3306 for news and information about Elite Dangerous and cool sci-fi and space news.
We record live on YouTube every Friday night at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. That's 1 a.m. UTC, so come and join in on the fun.
If you're listening to us on the podcast, please make sure to rate and review us on iTunes, Google Podcasts, Spotify, or whatever platform you use. And let us know if there's a format you want us to look into.
We don't do Patreon, so save your money and just tell your friends about the show.
Hell yes. Tell your friends about the show. All right. So right off the bat, we're going to start off with...
It's the Dark Wheel update.
That's right. Yes, it is the Dark Wheel update. So guess what, guys, boys and girls? The Dark Wheel is pending expansion out of LP787-52 as of around, what, Monday? This should take us to the undisclosed test site. It's redacted for LFT-509. Once there, we'll have two tests. A, just landing there. What does that unlock a permit or do anything? And B, once we take the system and expand from it with a shape jump to 509, what happens then? I want to give a huge shout out to the Black Sky Legion, which is BSL-1 Squadron on computer. And we've got, I think next week we'll have some information for you on a PlayStation Squadron for BSL-1 starting up. And also, hopefully soon, a Xbox, because we want to have everything covered for BSL-1 Black Sky Legion. Wolf, you've been doing a lot of work with the Black Sky Legion out of shaping the jump and 78752. We kept it quiet because we didn't want to deal with any sort of, opposition. And I think our subterfuge worked. We're 3-0 at the Merculus Hue, whatever, that we landed in. And things are going well on the jump, it seems like. You know, we don't want to give out any details, any information that we're not supposed to, but it seems like things are going pretty well. Why don't you hop in and give some shout outs to some people and tell us, you know, how things are going on your end?
Oh, things are going quite well. I actually just finished up doing my day before BGS stuff, so I'll have my usual recon team helping me out when the tick happens. so that as soon as I get data, I can post orders not only to the Black Sky Legion and the Rabbit Hamster Assault Force tomorrow morning, but also an update to the standing orders for the general public. We should be done with that war to get the number two spot in 86 Mu Hercules, and we want to continue that climb to take over the system because, hey, we got there. It wasn't owned by anybody, so now it's going to be owned by us. Add it to the list of systems that have the Dark Wheel flag flying on a station.
Hell yes. And let me ask you, as somebody, you've put in a lot of work on this over the last, you know, couple months, and, you know, overall, over the life of this mission, you've got thousands of people that have been sort of answering the call and stepping up for the Dark Legion over the last year and doing work, some just here and there periodically, some religiously day to day. Let me ask you, what do you think about LFT 509 and how do you feel about the project as a whole?
I think LFT 509 poses our greatest chance of finding something interesting in the game, be it a permit or whatnot, from the information we have about the system. The smart money's there. Sol was a neat little test, and I'm glad we were able to get that done. It was one hell of an effort required by everybody, and thank you for contributing your time and flight hours making that happen, because doing an expansion inside of the most trafficked area of the bubble, the heart of Federation space, that was unpleasant. I am glad we're moving back outwards away from all the traffic, where I don't have to spend so many hours just staring at a screen, looking at numbers, and then shaking the magic eight ball to see what we should do.
Right. Okay.
But it's been a lot of fun. I've learned way more about this game than I thought was even a thing. And I'm still intimidated as hell that there are so many people contributing to this project and just waiting to see what I post up. And it's like, all right, copy that. We'll go do that. Yeah, I mean, we're getting it done. I can't ask for anything else.
Hell yes. All right. Well, beep, beep. This is a editor's note for Monohive. Edit, make an edit. I just want to call out for the live stream. Rear Admiral Flaps rating us with 59 people on Twitch. Yo, brother, big salute. Love you, man. You got to come back on again soon sometime. All of you guys that are coming to us from Rear Admiral Flaps that are like, what is going on here? This is Elite Week. Every Friday night, late night. Well, not late night for America, but late night for the UK, we do a drinking party / news show where it's basically just a drunken night out at the pub with your friends before COVID, if you could talk all of your friends into playing Elite. So that's what this is, and we hope that you follow us and enjoy the show. All right, Monohive, edit, back in. Beep, beep. All right, so let me ask you a question, Wolf. With regard to the whole project, you know, basically we're at a point where, like, we can only do what we can do and see if Frontier responds. How do you feel with regard to, like, what do you think the chances are that Frontier will do something or not do something when we land in LFT 509? Because I know with your leadership in figuring out the landing and shaping it, and all of the people of the Black Sky Legion and the Rapid Hampshire Assault Force and the other workers for the Dark Wheel, we will land at our target site, which we're not going to say what it is for opposition reasons. But if we actually get there and nothing happens, and it seems fairly obvious that Frontier doesn't feel like engaging or doing anything with this, I mean, how do you feel at that? Like, what do you think at that point is the situation?
I think it would be a supremely big oof and a missed opportunity on their part. We have, in the course of, hey, let's figure this out, gotten a massive amount of players together to do a non-official, non-sanctioned, and mostly non-recognized community event in Elite. And it's been one hell of a ride. We've been doing this for just almost a year, going back to your original post date in the thread on the forums.
Yeah. And that was, to be clear, that was back in May of 2020 when there was no CGs, there was no Galnet, there was no anything, and we were keeping people sort of going in the game and keeping things alive.
I would hope they do something. Something, any something, would be better than nothing. I would supremely hate to see them throw away a perfectly good opportunity to have some finalization, meaningful engagement. You know, maybe it's because of what we're doing, there's some whatever policy on their end that says thou shalt not say anything about this whatsoever until they're done. Which, okay, fine, dandy, that's completely plausible. But I just hope at some point something either happens or they say something or whatnot. Otherwise, it's gonna feel like we were just doing this for ha-has, which, to be honest, we are. But we're honestly hoping to find out, you know, some mysteries in the game. Maybe we do, maybe we don't. We found perfectly good data for Lave, how that didn't pan out to anything spectacular. And also we found Shinrarda, we found out that that's got special BGS. Mm-hmm. We actually had them comment on that.
Yep.
And then for Sol, you know, Hutton Orbital got in there a while back and were taken out saying this wasn't for you. So the question, well, who is it for? Maybe the Dark Wheel. We've not 100%, I'd say 99% answered the question in that it's not for the Dark Wheel. There's still a way that maybe it could be entered
in the future.
But the requirements of doing that sort of a test are so astronomically difficult and time consuming that the answer might as well be 100% no.
Yep, I get you.
So we got an answer. We didn't get the answer we were looking for, but we got an answer. And we couldn't have done that without everybody's help.
Yep. When you're doing a scientific test, all you can do is set it up and witness the results. You can't make it be what you want it to be. You just have to see what happens. And in the end, either Frontier will engage on this or they will ignore the work done by many, like literally thousands of their commanders over the past year. And we'll see. It's up to them to decide. All right, next up, we have a new segment for the show. We have a moment of Zen brought to you by David Braben. So here's your moment of David Braben. Check it out. Hear what he had to say, the great man himself, back in the Kickstarter days. And then we'll take that information and we'll look at the world that we're living in with through that lens and see what we think.
Hello, I'd like to talk a bit about procedural generation. Procedural generation is one of those techniques that I think is not used as much as it could be, but is really a piece of magic whereby a vast amount of content, of rich content, can be created that would otherwise take a long time to make. So an example in Elite of how procedural generation worked is the whole galaxy was laid out by the computer. In other words, it drew all the star systems one by one around the galaxy, placed them based on what looked like random numbers. So it would essentially roll a dice and say, right, okay, there's a star here, roll the dice again, there's another star here. And that process would continue until all 256 stars were in the galaxy. When I say roll the dice, it would be generating a random number. And that random number came from what's called a random number sequence. So although the random numbers look random, they would actually be the same each time. So whenever it generated a galaxy, it would generate exactly the same galaxy each time. So talking a little bit about how that's done, you start off with something called a seed. So here we have a seed, which is the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. And then it just add those together. Now, this isn't actually the sequence that was used in Elite. It was a bit more complex one, but it shows very quickly, you see, but when you add them together, you get the next numbers in the sequence and so forth. Now, let's imagine taking those numbers and just looking at the last two digits. So forget the upper digits. So here we see there's a sequence going forward. To the eye, that looks pretty random. And actually, if you put a lot of analysis tools, mathematical analysis tools on to get the upper digits, it does, so it is random. It has the same properties, even distribution, all that sort of thing. Not particularly this sequence, which was from a guy called Fibonacci many years ago, but other sequences have much better sort of characteristics. Now, so what Elite did is it ran these, and it can run them really, really quickly for the whole galaxy, and it took a tiny fraction of a second to lay out the whole galaxy this way. And what you can do is just look in sequence to see which ones are near you, and then plot them on the map. And that's how it worked. Now, it also, as an extension of that, you say, okay, we've got this planet that's at coordinates 25, 76 or whatever. You say, what should we call it? Well, you can say take the same philosophy to choose its name. With Frontier, we took that a step further. What happened there is whole star systems were created. As you go to increase the distance away from the star, mass increases and then tails off until you get all the way out towards Pluto and the distant asteroids and very, very distant bodies in the star. Mass increases. Now, within that mass is distributed momentum. And there's a lot of science, which I won't go into here, which is why it's distributed the way it is. Interestingly, we also have, within our own solar system, a number of sub-solar systems which have very, very similar properties. So, for example, if you look at Saturn, you look at Jupiter, you'll see that, again, they have a mass distribution around them. You have Saturn with its rings, which everyone believes, including me, that they're quite transient, and they're for some body that collapsed and formed those rings. But nevertheless, you have a mass distribution around Saturn which has very, very similar ratios. What happened with Frontier is I made those assumptions and just saw what came out randomly, again using the same technique we've described, saw what came out randomly and whether the solar systems looked realistic. Now, incredibly, they did. With Frontier, of course, it was before a single planet was discovered. So it's very exciting as we go forward, as more and more planets are discovered, that real life seems to be getting close to that. I'm a huge fan of science fiction films. And one of the problems that I thought with Frontier and with the First Encounters game is the surfaces were marble hard. And I think that is a real shame when you're talking about gas giants like Saturn, like Jupiter, like Uranus, like Neptune. What I imagine would be the case, particularly with Jupiter, where you've got a very active, very colourful atmosphere, is there would be towering clouds everywhere. There would be lightning strikes. The world is a very, very interesting world. And it would be beautiful to fly in amongst those clouds with spaceships. So one of the technologies we've been looking at is how do we do that? How do we generate really rich cloudscapes? So it's early days yet, but here is an example of such a piece of technology. What we're seeing here is, again using procedural techniques, generating clouds on the fly, and you can feel yourself flying through them. We can have layers of these, we can change the colours, but imagine how great that will feel. Visiting a system like Jupiter, you know, it doesn't have to be empty. There'll be other people there, the people getting gas from the system, because we already know in both Elite and Frontier you could scoop fuel from the surface. You know, a gas giant's actually a very good place to do it because it's not quite as hot as the sun. But also, of course, these techniques can apply to the surfaces of stars, particularly cold stars like red giants. And so I think bringing that sort of richness to the world that we just haven't yet seen in games, I think is very, very exciting, what it would look like, what the world would feel like to fly through. And just from a gameplay point of view, tactically, you can lurk in clouds where maybe people can't see you because there are electrical storms which make your scanners not work very well. You know, all of those things, I think, are very exciting going forwards. Now, there are plenty of more things we can do, from the layouts of planet surfaces, all that sort of thing. So I think the richness we can bring to the world with procedural generation, still as a way of helping what artists can do, is very exciting. One of the issues, in fact, questions that come up a lot with procedural generation is just how good the results will be. And I think that what's in the back of people's minds is whether it will feel very samey. Now, obviously that's very possible, and it depends how you use it, because one of the things that I've been saying with this is it's a way of augmenting what artists do. And if you think of the procedural generation as essentially following the steps in a recipe, what the artist is doing is providing the ingredients. And if the ingredients are varied enough, then so is the end result. So if you compare, for example, a national park in the US, like the Joshua Tree National Park, where you've got slightly weird-looking cacti, big boulders all placed around the place in what looks like a very strange way, but incredibly beautiful. Compare that with, say, a national park in the UK, where you've got mature oak trees, very, very different feel to it, different colour palette, how it works, different shape of the landscape. They could both be done by the same technique, but look completely different. And it's the content that comes from the artist that makes it feel different. That's true of however it's done, whether it's layouts of planets, landscapes, what's in there. And so I think that is what provides the richness and the range, and that's what we intend to do here. So I think used carefully, used well, the results can be really good, and that's how we plan to do it.
All right. So, yes, I'm aware that apparently there's some kind of an issue. You guys are just going to have to bear with it for this live show. We'll figure it out. Spent $500 on an XLR and a special mic and all kinds of shit, and still stuff gets fucked up. So, sorry, but we'll figure it out. It is what it is. You're going to have to bear with it for tonight. All right. So that was David Braben, and he was talking about sort of procedural generation and how you can use it to really make an in-depth and like super, super, how do I say it? Make a whole world that is like massively in depth and diverse and real, and I don't know, and it's a situation that it's that is David Braben during the Kickstarter talking about, you know, what they're going to do to make the most of things. And I put it to you, listener, Elite Dangerous Commander, is that what you're seeing? If it is, then great. And if it's not, then let's talk about it. Specifically, how about we start with a little look at the stations in the Odyssey Alpha. Now, I should say that this is the Alpha thus far. You know, this is early days, and we have to see how does this add up to, you know, what we're looking for. Now, this is a video from Cerment, C-E-R-M-E-N-T, Odyssey Alpha Phase 2 Station Comparison. You will find a link in the show notes to this video. And, yeah, what I'm seeing here is basically the exact same station with Instagram filters. One looks a little more bleached out. One looks a little darker. One looks a little, it's slightly different color palette changes, but it's the same people in the same stations everywhere across the galaxy. Now, from what we just saw from David Braben, where he was talking about using procedural generation to vary things up and to change things all throughout the galaxy, I'm seeing Instagram filters. Maybe I'm wrong. Explain to me if you think that I'm wrong, why and how. But I'm seeing the exact same fucking bald kid sleeping on the exact same bench in every station across the galaxy. And I would love to hear your feedback on that. All right. So, guys in members of the cast, we've got Roy first. Go ahead.
I mean, it's obvious Yeah, it's very obvious when you're looking at these side-by-side slide-across comparisons. Can you not hear me?
I'm seeing you light up, and now I'm not hearing you. Again,
I'm hearing him.
Monohive, edit this. Hold on. We're going to change stuff around, because apparently... Roy, are you muted?
No, and Tweak can hear me, too.
I cannot hear you. Jesus fucking Christ.
This is where everybody, if you can hear us in the chat, gets to take a drink.
Down to Earth says they can
now
hear,
I hear
Roy
you.
As well.
Now I hear okay. you guys. All right. I was changing All stuff right. on the output because I was trying to deal with the stupid fucking reverb problem in our videos. All right. Go
no
ahead,
worries,
Roy.
No worries. Yeah. So, like, obviously, when you see this video with the slide across, it's very obvious. I didn't realize how close it was having visited several of these stations. I figured they were structurally similar. For me, the thing that it really is, if any of it's slightly immersion breaking, it's the having the exact same NPCs that stand out, like the sleeping guy on the bench or the mission giver standing in exactly the same spot each time. Those seem like things that could be randomized or even just turned on and off in different stations to avoid a really intrusive kind of immersion breaking reuse problem.
Yep. As I called out last week. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's my thought on that.
Tweet.
All right. Again, I'm going to preface this with saying I can only watch the streams, and I've watched all of the streams I can get my hands on.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot play it. That being said, this is just flat out, and I'm not a coder, but this is flat out lazy to me. I've played a lot of video games through my time, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, but we're all gamers here. And even games 10, 15, 20 years ago had more randomization than this. FDev, early on in this process, promised us that we would have stations that would be similar in the way they were set up, but would have variations in them. So far, I'm not really seeing any variations. They also said that the decor of the station would be dependent upon a faction's BGS, the owner, the faction that owns the system, so on and such forth. I, to this point, have not seen any evidence of that. Now, whether or not that feature is active at this stage of the alpha, we don't know. But if this is all that we get when this gets released, this is going to get stale and immersion breaking very, very quickly. And I totally agree with Roy. Having the NPCs the same in every station all the way across the galaxy, right down to Sleepy Pete, down to the mission givers, always standing in the same place. Sure, it makes it easy. I know exactly where to go, but it also is immersion breaking. It makes it feel fake. And if that's what we get, I almost wonder if this isn't bad for the game instead of great for the game, like I was hoping honestly would be.
Mm. Yeah. Well, we're going to leave this playing in the background so you guys can continue to see this for like another 10 minutes and you can judge for yourself. I don't want you to think that, you know, we're being overly harsh. It's the same station with the same people in the same places, and the difference is... wait, why does it say... Oh, I'm sorry. I was looking. I'm like, dude, I'm not a fan of censorship. Why is it saying Big C75's message was deleted? It said it was retracted, so he took it back. That's okay. All right. Yeah, it's the same people in the same places. And yikes. That's big oof. Big oof. Roy, you had a comment from chat?
Yeah, Mr. Ron in chat brought something up that I think is fair. It's that, you know, they're testing a lot of complicated systems right now, and it may just be that this is not one that's slated to be shown beyond its current complexity. I'm sort of paraphrasing there. So
maybe
it's very, you know, I hope that's the case. I hope that's the case that when this goes live, they're going to be turning a lot of more of the knobs so we can see more variation. Let's hope so.
Hey, man, if come launch, this is not the same, this is different in different stations all over the galaxy, I will be the first to give a big salute and say, okay, I was worried for nothing. But if come launch of Odyssey we see this, oof. All right, next up we've got Tweak's Console Corner, Every week, we're going to be giving Tweak an opportunity to deliver a little segment with a console player's perspective. Every content creator out there is just all about Odyssey, Odyssey, Odyssey right now. And I think it's very important that we highlight all of the people, specifically the console players, who don't have a chance to get in on this right now, and let us hear their thoughts. Tweaked? Rock out.
Well, all right. As a console player, I would lie if I didn't say I was a little frustrated. The very little, almost nothing we've heard about working on the console port of Odyssey, and I get it, they're working on the alpha for PC right now, and that's all fine and good, but they could at least let us know they're still working on it. And to Art's credit, I guess, he did say that, although he kind of slipped and said that they weren't working on it just yet. That being said, I have to take that with a grain of salt and just take it for what it is. If they can get this right, if they can get this alpha working right and get Odyssey released to PC and going well, then I have to hope that they'll be on track to get it to console for us and working fairly well.
Hmm.
But what I am seeing, I know a lot of people, I share a lot of these streams and videos to my Discord, to OPIC's Discord, and some of the people want to watch them, mm-hmm. but there's a fairly large group of people that have no interest in watching anything Odyssey, because a lot of people don't believe it's coming to Xbox or PlayStation. They think that it's too much for the old consoles, and they don't believe it's going to get there. They think it might get to the next generation, but they think it's going to get delayed past the fall. So they are totally ignoring it at this point in time, and I think that's bad for the game, personally. I personally, of course, I love Odyssey. I love what this could become for the game, so I try to get everybody to understand that it is what it is, and we just have to wait. We have to hope that they do us right.
Mm.
But the general consensus, I think, of console players is we're a little nervous at this point in time, to be totally honest.
I think with good reason. All right. So that takes us to an in-game event that is, you know, in the current game, in the live build. Not everything all week has been, every content creator has been alpha, alpha, alpha. Let's not forget the live build of the game. The continuation of the Adamastra mystery. This specifically was the Hesperus and the treasure ships. Now, first off, as we discussed last week, there's a mystery patron. There's somebody in the game that is sending you missions to go uncover stuff, and they've got a cool little spy nickname. I'm gonna try to not spoil too much, but you know, we talked about it last week and gave our thoughts of who we think it is. Now let's talk about the event in game, what actually happened. First off, very cool event. Much props, much love to Frontier for pulling this in. It was cool and it's keeping things spicy in the live game. However, gotta say, typo in the message in the fucking beacon. This has been a reoccurring theme. Like the last Adamastra event, there was a typo in the message on the thing. Like, guys, no offense, but fix your shit. If you're putting out a live mystery for your people to play, like, quality assurance test it. If you have a typo in your fucking beacon message, that shows that you were too lazy to actually look and see if it was correct. That's just, oof, yikes. And as Down to Earth in the comment section, he's watching us live and is saying here on YouTube, there's too much brute forcing in some of these. Lately, it seems like Frontier has two modes on their mysteries. The first mode is it's solved within a half an hour. The second mode is it takes 4 to 5 days to fix because they couldn't fucking quality test their shit. And they put out a mystery with a typo in it that you can't solve until they fix it. And unfortunately, in this particular case, the way that they went to fix it was a community manager was watching the Canon Discord, where they said this doesn't make sense. It gives us like bad info. We think this is bugged. And Zach, a community manager at Frontier Developments, responded on the Canon Discord and said, "Whoops, we screwed up. Here's the correct message. This will allow you to finish the mystery." Okay, here's the problem with that. You didn't fucking update your own forums. You literally went to Canon and gave them the correct answer so that they could figure it out first. Now, I want to be clear on this. I am not calling out Canon. This is not their fault. They didn't have to, but I want to credit them. They went and updated the official Frontier forums within, like, I don't know, whatever, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, what, in under half an hour, they shared the information that a community manager gave them only with the whole world to try to make it sort of fair. Like, that was very, very kind and very, very egalitarian of them. Canon, Interstellar, you know, they deserve much love and much respect on how this entire process played out. But the community managers who don't fucking bother to update their own forums, like, here's the proper answer. Number one, for the love of Christ, 7 out of the last 10 fucking events that you've done have had a typo in it that fucked it up. That's embarrassing. Fix your shit. But if you're not going to do that, and you're going to continue to have typos where shit's fucked up to artificially extend what would be a 2-hour event into a 3 or 4 or 5 day event and make yourself look good, then for the love of Christ, fix it on your own forums and then tweet it out on the official Elite Dangerous or on the official Frontier Twitter so that the entire community has a fair shot at getting to the thing at the same time. Do not continue your habit of letting a private Discord know, "Oh, by the way, here's the real answer." Fuck everybody else. That's embarrassing. Please be better. Do better. You owe it to us. Do better. That's amateur hour bullshit. All right. Let's start with Wolf has a comment and then Tweaked has a comment. Go.
So, of note, recently, the last oof they had with respect to a misspelling was in the names of the systems with memorials.
Oof.
So, there seems to, like you said, there's a trend of QA, QC slippage, or maybe not being done. I don't know. But one would think that, hey, this is an in-game thing. Here's a puzzle that's got to be solved. That's going to have more visibility and more reviewers, approvers, checkers, whatever word you want to use there associated with it, than opposed to, hey, if you want to go see the memorials, here's where to go. And too bad it's not TNE slip.
Yeah, but I mean, honestly, there's no excuse for any of, like, seriously, dude. If you're posting this shit and you're a fucking $1.6 plus billion dollar company, maybe fucking spell check your shit and post it right. Tweaked.
Yeah, I'll agree with what you said, Kai, that Canon should not take any heat nor be blamed for this.
Dude.
This was a bad move on the...
I can't say strongly enough. Canon were fucking angels here. They went and immediately shared the information with the whole community the way that the community managers should have known to from the start. Canon are fucking heroes here. Sorry, go ahead.
Right. No, but I was going to say, the days of doing it this way for Frontier should be over. Even given that the canon was bad, but even having to put it on the forums, in my mind, is the wrong move. There are probably thousands of players that don't even ever look at the forums. There are plenty of ways that FDev could have put it in game. They could put it on the launcher screen where
yes.
you look at your ship in the docking bay. It tells you where you docked last and stuff. They could put it there easily. They could send every commander in the galaxy a message in our comms panel and get the information out that way. Not everybody goes to these Discords. Not everybody goes to the FDev forums. And there's no excuse for them not doing it in game anymore.
Canon.
I don't care about the money. I don't care that the first 10 guys out there were canon and they got the money. I didn't need the money. But for future events like this, mm-hmm. Frontier really needs to go back to the drawing board and figure out how they get this information out to us all.
Again, number one, spell check your shit to get it right at first. It's a fucking mystery that everybody's playing. But on the off chance that you do have a mistake, number one, tweet it. Number two, put it on the forums. Number three, put it in an in-game mail to every commander in the galaxy. And number four, put it on the launcher screen and do it all at the same time so everybody has the same shot. Wolf.
Going to the forums thing where it might not have the visibility that they think it does. I didn't even have a forum account set up until I needed to be the one posting up the standing orders for turning the wheel.
Like, absolutely.
I would go and view, like you can go view it anonymously. But what there was for me to see, it's like, okay, this is a lot of, don't want to be involved in that, and just clicked it away and would just go watch their Twitter or whatever if I wanted to get quote unquote news.
Right
and
on.
Then I found, you know, the bots and I could just watch those feeds and didn't have to click anywhere. They all came to me in Discord.
There you go. Roy.
So Mark Xanthius in Twitch has an interesting observation. It looks like, and he can't quite confirm it, but he thinks there was a message sent like in the comm panel. I'm curious if anybody else can confirm this from chat on either service, but
I didn't see it.
A correction was sent to people that had scanned it already that would have showed up as a comm message. So it may have required you were, you know, in game at the time that was sent. I'm not sure when it was sent out or how long it persisted, or if it would sort of repetitively be sent out if you went and scanned the wrong message again. So it's a little unclear. Maybe there was some attempt made at doing something in game. Unclear how well the execution of it was.
Okay. Now, having said all of that, and I'll be honest, I was hot from the having it sort of like, come on again with the type on your events, like more than 50% of your event, like 80%+ of your events have typos. Like, that's embarrassing. Fix your shit. Having said that, let me say it's kind of an awesome event. There were multiple steps to it. It was interesting. Like, aside from the fact that they, number one, broke it because they can't put shit out right, and number two, gave favoritism by giving the answer to one group over everyone else. If you can get past that, it was an awesome event. And I want to give a huge shout out to Remlock Industries. There is a French players group called Remlock Industries that are fucking awesome. They have people in there that put out good art. They have people in there that put out breakdowns on scientific stuff, including, and there's a link in the show notes, to the Remlock Industries breakdown for this event. I think they were the first ones that put out a really good, like a phenomenal breakdown to this event. Roy, go ahead and throw that in the Twitch chat. I'm going to throw a link to it also in the YouTube chat so that both sides have this information. Huge shout out to Remlock. And you know what? Aside from the fact that they fucked it up, huge shout out to Frontier. It's a cool event. They did good. While we're shouting out Remlock Industries, I want to give a personal shout out to at Gamayun, Gamayun26 at Twitter for his amazing art. Let's see here. Crap, I was supposed to put a link to it. I think it was three. Nope. It was five. That right there, the picture you're seeing on screen that has that beautiful, like, purplish whatever moon with a weird ring, and there's another gas giant with a ring in the background. That's what we use as the official art asset for the Elite Week clips, the weekly clips where we break stuff out and share it with people. That came from this guy right here at GAMAYUN26 on Twitter, who is a member of Remlock Industries. So, cool. Like, there is this very fucking cool French group that is, I think they're a big PlayStation 4 group, and they are, like, killing it on putting out stuff. So, huge salute, and, you know, the only thing I know is, you know, Viva la guerre, viva la legionnaire, like, viva la Remlock Industries. You guys are fucking awesome. So, big salute to you guys. Great player group. I always like shouting out player groups that are sort of, you know, very, very good. Let's see here. Next up. So, when you locate the Hesperus and you find not only the Hesperus, but also dredger ships, this is fucking amazing. And I want to give huge salute. As much as I sort of shat on Frontier 5 minutes ago for continuing to put out typos in every event that they put out, I want to give them a huge salute for this. Dredger ships, and a lot of people don't even have a clue, like, dredger ships, what's that? Dredger ships were in the beta for Elite Dangerous, like 7-8 years ago, whatever. Forever ago, they were in the beta. They never made it into the live game. There are these huge, massive mega ships that have a big sort of weird force field thing in the front of the ship. And the lore is that it just sort of slowly goes through and it chews up nom, 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 anything that comes in front of it. It will destroy asteroids and ships and stations and anything that comes in front of it. It'll just chew through it, break it down to its components, and it takes those and it uses it as manufacturing materials to synthesize anything that the ship needs to keep it going. It's fucking amazing. In the show notes for this episode, we will have the wiki link, the fan wiki link for both the dredger ship and the dredger clans. The story is that these dredger ships are these old outdated ships that were no longer sort of deemed useful by the major powers because they have frameshift drives now. These were pre-frameshift drives. And these dredger clans sort of bought them up. Imagine like an old, like a very, very, very old cruise ship that was surplus that got sold off, and these weird cults and groups and clans would buy them. And you've got, literally, you've got the Faygo clan, which is hilarious to me because, like, Faygo is like, you know, the what do you call those guys? The Juggalos. They drink Faygo in Detroit. It's like a cheap soda. But anyways, they're this like cannibal clan that flies through the galaxy just fucking people up if they get to them. In this particular case, the lore behind this event was that it was the Scrivener clan, which was these guys that, like, their job is they're making this sort of super duper knowledge base of, like, oh, we keep all records, all knowledge, whatever. And they were going through, and they have a weird emblem that looks to me very Raxla-ish, but, like, yeah, super, super, super interesting. Tweaked, I know you went out and made a special trip out there. Why don't you tell us your thoughts on sort of all of this?
Yeah, yeah, that we did. Me, Totes McGoats, Plagued Reaper, a couple Opus guys, low 200. We all made our way out there the very next morning after this information was discovered.
And I got to say, at first, I was expecting it to be right in the nav panel, like the ghost ships have been, all that kind of stuff. And it wasn't. You had to search around for it. But big props to FDAV. While they may have tripped over their feet in the way the message got out, big props for the event itself. Because as soon as you dropped into that asteroid field, you had to actually hit your brakes. You had to fly your ship because you're going to run smack dab into the Hesperus. And right from that moment on, it was cool as hell. The detail of the ships, the dredger was amazing looking. All the auto turrets, just the level of detail that FDEV puts into this kind of stuff is second to none. Hmm. And it's where they really, really shine. And we stood there, we scanned everything. We got our 2 million credits or our 10 free Void Opal reward message. And honestly, I was tempted to fly into the dredger to see if I thought what would happen would happen, and it gave me a shortcut home.
There you go.
We died, but it saved me the 19 jumps back to the bubble, and boom, I was there. But what a great day of fun with a bunch of commanders, that some new content to sink our teeth into, which we are sorely, sorely needing at this point on console, at least. And it was just good fun all around. Props to FDEV.
Right on. Wolf.
This is where I prove I've been drinking way too much. Whenever I look at the dredger, I immediately think giant space catfish. Like giant catfish that they go noodling for down south. And, well, noodling's illegal because you could drown. Yeah, because you get your arm stuck in there and it just wants to eat it and nothing comes out unless you, like, wrestle it to the surface.
That's not even down south, bro. That's just Oklahoma. That's Okie noodling. Only place you see that is Oklahoma and maybe some parts of Louisiana. Yeah. All right. So I know there's a lot of people in, like, England that are like, what the fuck are you talking about? Just go to YouTube and type in Okie, O-K-I, noodling, N-O-O-D-L, I don't know, whatever. You're going to see these weird fucking rednecks shoving their arms in holes so that a big catfish will bite their hand, and then they clamp their hand down on the catfish and they yank it out of the hole, and they literally flop like a 40-pound catfish onto a boat. This is some weird fucking white trash redneck shit that you're praying to God you don't find a fucking eel, because he'll just clamp down and chew, or a turtle, snapper turtle, they'll just chew off one of your fingers, and that's why you get fucking weird-ass rednecks running around with eight fingers, because, yeah. All right. I'm probably just confused a bunch of people, but when you...
I have eight fingers. Don't we all have eight fingers? Sorry.
Yeah. You're from Oklahoma. Okay, cool. All right. So that... I'm just going to sum up the whole thing and say, yes, as always, Frontier fucked it up in how they do it. Stop doing that, please. But the event itself was cool. If they can start not having typos in their shit, that would be great. And it would make for very, very cool events. And again, unless anyone mistake my meaning here, Canon did no wrong. Canon actually did right by the community 100%. The community managers need to figure out their fucking job and post stuff where they're supposed to. Also,
I should add real quick, Kai. Sorry to interrupt, but I almost forgot. Big props to FDEV too. The system that they had us go to pick up our reward, I had never been to it before. Some other people had, some hadn't. What a beautiful system. The system is right in a nebula. It's an asteroid base you got to go to. So big props to FDEV for picking a spot that stands out like that. It was really a sight to see.
Hell yes. Hell yes. In addition to that, I want to say, in summation on the whole thing, there's more to this story coming soon. The mysterious man of science benefactor that is sending you on these missions, there's more coming. And the way they talked about it, I asked them on the live stream on Tuesday, and they've responded like, oh, there's more coming, and it's coming soon, very soon. The way that they said it, I would not be surprised if within 2 to 3 weeks we're seeing the next something here. So be aware, like, okay, this is a continuing story. It's very cool. Just fucking proofread your shit for the love of God. But it's cool. So big thumbs up. Which takes us to a section that we like to call...
For News Beyond the Game, it's Frontier News.
Yes, yes, Frontier News. So, let me scroll down right quick. Here we go. Streams. There was Super Cruise News episode 30 on Tuesday, which was Art, Bruce, Zach, Paul, and the return of Sally Morgan Moore. That's right. They announced it via a tweet like 2 hours before the stream. We have a new community manager that's joining us, and they'll be with us today. Tune in to see who it is. And lo and behold, it was Sally Morgan Moore. Now, you might be saying, I don't know who that is. What the fuck? Sally is awesome. Sally is good people. Sally, we all know and love Sally, all of the old-timers who have been with the game for a while. Sally was the product manager of Elite Dangerous. She had Al Hibbard's job. And then about a year and a half to two years ago, she left to go take a position elsewhere. She, you know, took a nice step up. She did her job well. She got a step up. And she moved on to another company. And she made another sort of step back just within the last week or so to Frontier. Now, Sally is much beloved because she is an awesome person who, for the whole time that she was playing Elite, would tweet stuff and she was, you know, doing cool stuff. But then also she went to go do Human Fall Flat and work on all that. And she stayed active in the Elite Dangerous community. And it was obvious from the things that she said and the things that she did that she still played. She would fly around in her pink wafer. And, you know, the pink wafer, she had a pink Cobra Mark III that is the pink, it's called the pink wafer. And, you know, she had her continuing adventures. And just in a world where so many sort of community managers and people seem like, she strikes me as just a genuinely good human being. So when she announced that she was back and on the stream, the content creator community and all of the people that knew her, all of the old players sort of went nuts and they were like, Sally's back. And it was a beautiful move. It was a good move. I give them Frontier, you know, huge props, big salute. Having Sally back, great thing. We'll say that now we have five community managers. We've had five community managers a few times before, and every time that we had five community managers, it was because one of the four older community managers was on their way out. Now, that doesn't mean they're leaving Frontier. That means they're leaving, you know, Elite Dangerous, the project. It might be that we see Art moving on to Warhammer or Formula One or another company. It might be we see Bruce moving on to one of those things or another project altogether. It might be that we see, you know, Paul or Zach. What, I don't know. We'll see. I do know that we don't normally see five community managers without one of the original four going, as I just said. So we will see how it goes. In the stream itself, I found it interesting. They answered like four of my questions, although every time they answered it, it was like, I see some commander said whatever. It's like, okay, can't say my name. That's fine, but you're answering my questions, so that's good. I asked, hey, when is phase three going to start? And they said it's going to happen on Thursday. I asked, hey, I can't help but notice that on the trailer, the video that you did for phase two, you said April 30th is the end date. And they said, it's not necessarily the end date. Don't expect that. It'll go till it's done. Maybe that's true. Maybe that's a lie. We'll see if it ends on April 30th or not. I asked, Have you guys seen the Punchaconda video where people just, you know, punched an anaconda to death in 10 minutes? Or have you seen the, where, you know, a guy takes a pistol and takes out a cobra? They said, yes, they had seen them both. And they don't think that that should be. And, you know, it's an alpha and things are in flux. We'll see how they end up. I asked, you know, hey, you guys said you were going to give us a UI stream probably last Thursday. We didn't get one last Thursday. It's now Tuesday. Are we going to get one soon? And they said, yes, one will be coming soon. It didn't come on Thursday. So soon, TM. These were a lot of, there were a lot of questions that were sort of gotten to. Now on Thursday, they did a stream, the Alpha Release 3 stream, the launch day stream with Twitch drops. Bruce, Art, and Sally. And you know what Twitch drops means, boys and girls. It means you're going to get absolutely no fucking useful communication in the actual stream itself. So we had the Twitch drop stream. In addition to that, on Thursday, they dropped the video, which was the Phase 3 trailer video. And here it is for you.
Hey guys, I'm Arthur, and today we're running down everything you need to know about organics and exobiology in 60 seconds, so start that timer. In Odyssey, we've completely revolutionized our planet system. This means new geological features and new pockets of organic life spread throughout the galaxy. Before you get started, you'll need to get dressed for the occasion, so bag yourself a Super Tech Artemis suit, complete with genetic sampler. We've quadrupled the number of species, and for the first time, you'll be able to sample any vegetation you might encounter. To track down organics, we recommend getting your wings and using the newly enhanced detailed surface scanner. This will generate a heat map whilst approaching a planet in supercruise, identifying prime locations which are capable of supporting organic life. Surface scan complete. Once you've found life, you'll need to use the sample tool to extract genetic data from your find. This will add data to your codex, but you'll need to find more examples in order to provide complete and saleable biodata. Three samples will do it, but you'll need to take these from a wide area to ensure diversity. Your sampler has a pulse scan which will quickly highlight if a specimen is suitable. Once done, you'll want to head back to port and visit Vista Genomics to sell your data. Any organics logged at Vista will be displayed on the planet map alongside the first commander to log them. If that's you, you'll receive a bonus. And that's a wrap. Thanks for watching, and please share your discoveries with us as we explore the Elite Dangerous Odyssey Alpha.
And that's a wrap. So there you have it. Art comes on and says, I'm going to explain everything you need to know about genetic sampling in 60 seconds. And then he proceeds to do a 2-minute video that does not explain anything about how to do genetic sampling. Okay, so yeah, there's that. I don't know what to say. I don't want to sound like a smartass. It's just like I don't know what else to say. Yeah. So despite the fact that he's like, yeah, you kind of honk for like the plants to light up, and then you collect them. Doesn't say how. Doesn't say about the whole thing where like you got to collect on from a plant and then collect from three other plants sort of in the area, but don't collect any other plants because that'll burn your original thing. And doesn't explain how the mini game works, and doesn't explain how just any of it. So like, yeah, okay, we're going to get to it in a little bit and we're going to talk about it. So that was the video that came out with the Thursday stream. We have also on the forums a hotfix got posted at noon today in Eastern time, which would be like what, 5 p.m. UTC. which had a bunch of stuff in there that got changed around, including they nerfed the plant stuff. People yesterday were like, the plant stuff is too hard. It's no good. They nerfed it. So they increased the pay and some other things as well. The link is in the show notes to the actual forum thread. Go read it. They do these, like, they're going to be two or three more hot fixes. So I'm not going to bother to sit there and read through all of it. You have it there, and there'll be more coming. Which take us to the Galnet stuff. Roy, take it away.
Yeah, so let's see here. We had four stories this week on April 12th, Galactic Mysteries Dredger Clans. Of course, we've just gone through all of that. That was the awesomely cool and slightly janky mystery event, the continuation of the Atom Aster. On April 13th, Federal Reactions to Communications Surveillance Program. I don't know, you may have some insight into this one. It seemed like a continuation of people making strongly worded letters to news organizations about how they didn't want surveillance increasing. But then others saying, well, you know, stations were on fire and we have to do something about it. April 15th, Archon Delane campaign to build new starports. So this is the lore background to the two CGs that have been created. And then finally on April 16th, we've got Neo-Marlinist Seek Sanctuary at Marlinist Colonies. That one sounds like it could stir up some trouble. Any comments from the crew on any of those before we continue on to the CGs?
So I thought there was a lot of good stuff in the Galnet. The Dredger Clan thing, like we talked about, awesome stuff. The federal reactions to the surveillance, oof, that's very Patriot Act-y. I'm not for it.
Yeah.
The Archon Delane building new starports. You know, obviously that's continuing on his little impromptu speech of like, yeah, I'm a despot and a tyrant just like all the rest of you. That's what government is. It's like, okay, now he's like, recognize me, build stuff for me, whatever. And it's like, okay. The last one, the Neo-Marlinists Seek Sanctuary at the Marlinist Colonies. That one, I'm very, very interested. I guarantee you that one has to have a follow-up in a couple of days. You don't get follow-ups on the weekends generally from Frontier, but I would expect on Monday, Tuesday to get some kind of follow-up of like, hopefully the peaceful Marlinists will tell the extremist Marlinists to fuck right off. Fingers crossed. We'll see. That's all I got. Anybody else? All right. Or onto the community goals, if not.
I think we're on to the community goals. So the two goals are related to Archon Delane. There's one that's combat related, and you're protecting the deliveries, and then there's the corresponding delivery CG. So the delivery one is already at 49% done.
Mm-hmm.
People are really jumping on that one. There's five new starports that could get built, and there's a list of them in the article. We've got it in the show notes as well. The combat one's just barely getting going, it looks like.
So when it comes down to flying combat air patrols for a pirate warlord, that's a little weird. With regard to the delivery one, it's like, okay, that's more traditional. I want to point out something I don't think a lot of people have really thought about. When it talks about, like, if we get the rewards, we're going to put in five new spaceports. And it's like, we're going to put one in Pegasi Sector PNT-C3-14 and HIP 18390 near the California Nebula. Cool, cool. And HIP 62154 near the Coalsack Nebula. Okay, cool, cool. Expanding the bubble. I like it. EOL Prow PCK-C9-91 near Colonia. Very cool. Expanding that little Colonia mini bubble. I dig it. And then there's HIP 10792. Boys and girls, HIP 10792 is near the Sothis system. I'm not sure how many people have thought this through. There is a sort of very lucrative money-making slash rep grind in Seos and Sothis, and having systems in Seos, having stations in Seos and Sothis. I'm too drunk to fucking talk right.
No, that's a tongue twister.
To go back and forth to, that is a way to make money and rep, and that is good stuff if that's what you're down for. If we put in a new station near Seos and Sothis, and God forbid it's got Empire factions in it, I think there's going to be some people pissed off when they do the math on that and find out that they're easy back and forth, A to B, B to A, A to B, B to A, A to B, B to A grind has now got a C in it, a turd in the punch bowl that is going to slow shit down. That's just something that occurs to me. I don't know if other people have thought of that. Wolf?
So, right now it's A to B, B to A, ad nauseum. All you're doing is federal stuff. Well, if I can get missions to go to C, to and from C, and there's Imperial factions there, I can do A, B, C, A, A, B, C, A, B, C, A, B, C, and grind both.
Maybe. Or maybe not. We'll see. Tweaked.
Yeah, I was going to say something along the same lines. You're right. It could totally put a wrench in the works, per se. Or if it's all federal factions again, I mean, the best Imperial grind bounces you between three systems, and it goes really quick. So if this turns into a third system for the Fed grind, it could work to its favor. Or, like you said, it could totally mess everything up.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a question mark. It could be good. It could be bad. We'll see. All right. The other thing I want to point out is on the previous, and I don't know if we mentioned this last week or not, but on the previous CG, obviously we had a week where it was the mystery, it was the Dredger mystery, but before that we had the CG with railguns. Yeah. I think we did call it out last week, but just in case we didn't, Frontier screwed up and sent out the railgun without the
feedback cascade.
The feedback cascade, the experimental effect. And they couldn't call it back in time, so what they ended up doing was just giving out a second one. So, yay, everybody, I think we did call it last week. Everybody got double railgun, so that's good.
Hell yeah.
Hells yeah. So right now, go out there and get your... Now, story-wise, this one doesn't have a strong hook for me. I don't give a fuck about Archon Delane. Like, you do your thing, you don't, whatever. It's not like the Marlinists where I was rooting for them. It's not like, you know, expanding to a new Coalsack. But although, I'll say this, though. It is sort of expanding. It's expanding the bubble a little bit, so that has a nice hook. I'm not a fan of Archon Delane. And this one doesn't have a special module. This is just some cash. Doesn't have a paint job. Doesn't have anything fancy. But I am in favor. So if you're hearing the sound of my voice and you're like, I don't know if I care or not, like, I'll probably go and do some of this because I am in favor of expanding the bubble. And that's what this is. So, yeah. All right. That takes us to a little section that we like to call...
Real life science.
Real life science. We're going to run through them quick. This is just down and dirty. We'll give you the links. Go in the show notes of the YouTube video and actually go and watch the full videos. I'm going to give you a super brief breakdown of each one. We're not going to spend time on this, but we want you to have it. Right off the bat, Astrum put out a video, a comprehensive review of the 15-year Opportunity rover mission to Mars. They had some clickbaity title for it of like, oh, the amazing thing that we found on Mars and you got to see it. Fuck clickbait, man. This is the real, I gave it my own title because it's a better one. It's like an hour-long video that does an amazing job showing you the 15 years of the mission of the Opportunity rover. It is fucking amazing. Go watch it and see. This is the predecessor to Perseverance. This is showing you step by step where they went, what they found, all the science, all the stuff. Weird lawsuit in the middle of it. where people were claiming that NASA was hiding aliens or whatever, and it's like, no, fuck. It's, but I mean, it is, dude, I watched the whole thing end to end, and I, at the end, I was like, I want to start over again and watch it. It's fucking beautiful. Like, the the real science is so much better than fucking sci-fi bullshit. Go enjoy this. This is legit. Next up, Anton Petrov put out a video, China's secretive Mars mission update, what we know so far. It did a phenomenal job of showing what's going on with the mission to Mars, Tianwen 1, which is Heavenly Questions 1. And I didn't even know this. I didn't, as much study as I've done on the whole thing, I didn't know the rover that they're sending is a teeny tiny little thing that's only going to be running for like 90 days mission, whatever. Now, a lot of times they'll give you like a mission extension of like 90 days, and really it's going to work for like 4 or 5 months, but 90 days is like they're safe. Like they can say, hey, we didn't fail no matter what. They give it a very, very conservative estimate. But it's actually a multi-package payload or multi-payload package where the rover is just one part of it. There's a huge, much larger part of it is the satellite that's going around and the stuff that they're doing. And they're super secretive of where they're going and what they're doing. But there's some neat stuff involved. And Anton talks about the fact that, like, the next space race, like, it's not talked about much, sort of, I don't think, by the general population. But in the halls of power, you know, at NASA, at the ESA, you know, at different, at Roscosmos, it's known the next space race has already started, and it's the USA versus China, and it's big. And you know what? As much as I'm not for jingoistic fucking nationalistic bullshit, if it's going to, if a space race is going to get us going the way that it did, it got us off of our ass with regard to the moon when there was a space race between us and Russia, I'm for it. Like, yes, let's do it. Let's whatever. If it gets Congress and whatever to actually put money into funding, fuck yes, let's do it. Let's have a space race. And hopefully there'll be enough collaborations. Hopefully the ESA collaborates with us and the Roscosmos, the Russians collaborate with the Chinese, and it just pushes stuff enough. If that's what you have to do to get the old men in power to hand over money to do science, fuck it. I give up. Let's do it. Let's turn it into a race. Awesome stuff. Go check it out. Also, Anton Petrov put out, finding isoprene on another planet means alien life, but what is it? It's a very cool video that explains isoprene, like, in specific, and what it is and how it works and whatever. And the fact of the matter is almost all living things that we know of put out, including us, put out isoprene. It's in our breath. It's in plants. It's in everything, pretty much everywhere. All animal life puts off isoprene. But on planets with a lot of oxygen, it goes away super fast because the oxygen sort of eats up the isoprene. And what we end up with is a lot of methane, but you don't see isoprene. Well, there could be, though, other planets elsewhere that are not oxygen-based, in which case you would see the isoprene just out there easily to be detected. As we go through our next generation of exoplanet hunting, you know, satellites and stuff, the current version, the current satellites don't have the ability to search for isoprene. They're not technically capable for that. But the next generation of satellites that we're coming out with are putting that on the agenda. It is a thing. And if the ESA or NASA or Roscosmos or I'm embarrassed to say I don't know the name of the Chinese, whatever. But if any of the big groups get the tech and get it right and start searching the way the ESA has been doing with exoplanets for a bit, and we find isoprene, that is almost a dead giveaway that it's like there's some life. It might not be life that we recognize, but there's some life of some kind on that planet. And that is super, super exciting to me as saying, like, this is where we're going to see where we're going to be aiming our efforts in the next 10 generations to try to reach out and strive for and to see what's going on in the galaxy. And the last thing I have for you, and I'm going to bring up a little asset for you here on the screen. PBS put out PBS Spacetime, a video on YouTube. What if dark matter is just black holes? And in that video, there's a sneaky little Thargoid appearance at the 8-minute, 14-second mark. It shows up on the screen there. You can see right there is the picture. That's the graphic that they used on PBS television. And you got a little Thargoid there. You've got a couple other cool little sci-fi, you know, space game stuff. There's a Reaper. Yeah. But I just thought, holy shit, PBS put out a thing on TV that had a Thargoid out there. That is a segment producer who is a fan of Elite Dangerous. So I wanted to give them a big salute. Huge 07. Much love. That's some cool, cool shit. Let's transition from real life science into a sort of, scientifically...
Some of the science in Elite.
Yeah. It's scientifically based, but it's elite news or elite information. There's a thing that I came across earlier in the week, and I gave it to Roy and said, put together a segment on this. This is good stuff. And it's
cool,
it's about prominent astronomical names. Take it away, Roy.
Yeah, so many of the stars that we all can find in Elite Dangerous's galaxy map, they share prefixes in their name, like LHS or LTT, and then there's a number, or Ross, and then there's a number. And what you may not realize is, especially if you're relatively new to the game or astronomy in general, is that these are actual names of real-life stars, and the prefixes refer to the real-life star catalogs where the parameters of the star are recorded. That's interesting enough, but what I thought was really cool is a common way of detecting nearby stars that's been used for a very long time is to look for relatively high proper motions of the stars. And this is how several of the catalogs get grouped together. So, for example, proper motion, a quick explanation of that as it applies to stars is that over the course of centuries, stars appear to maintain nearly fixed positions with respect to each other so that they form the same constellations that we name in the sky over historical time. You know, Ursa Major or Crux, for example, look nearly the same now as they did hundreds of years ago. However, precise long-term observations have shown that the constellations change shape, albeit very slowly, and that each star has an independent motion. So this motion is caused by the movement of the stars relative to our sun and the solar system. The sun travels in a nearly circular orbit, it's called the solar circle, around the center of the galaxy at a speed of around 220 kilometers per second at a radius of, as many in the game know, around 26,000 light years from Sagittarius A star. And this can be taken as the rate of rotation of the Milky Way itself at this radius. So a common way of detecting nearby stars is to look for relatively high proper motions. And several catalogs exist that are formed this way. Ross and Wolf catalogs pioneered this. At Yerkes Observatory, Frank Ross, he was the successor to the late E.E. Barnard, as in Barnard Star, Barnard's Loop, inheriting Barnard's collection of photographic plates. So they used to take these pictures on basically glass plates with photographic solution. And he decided to repeat the same series of images and compare the results with a device called a blink comparator, so you can quickly move between the two images. And in doing so, he discovered 379 new variable stars and over 1,000 stars that had high proper motion. And some of these high proper motion stars turned out to be quite nearby. And many of these stars, such as Ross 154, still widely known by the catalog number he gave them. Another series of catalogs, stars with prefixes in Elite like LHS, LTT, LFT, those are from catalogs created by Jacob Luyten. He was born in Semarang, Java in the Dutch East Indies. And at the age of 11, he observed Halley's Comet. This started his fascination with astronomy. The proper motion catalogs he created were grouped and named after the amount of proper motion observed in those stars. So LFT a star whose prefix begins with LFT is in the Luyten 5/10 catalog, LFT. So that's stars with proper motions exceeding 0.5 or 5/10 of an arc second annually. Similarly, LHS, that's for Luyten half second catalog. LTT is the Luyten 2/10 catalog. NLTT, new Luyten 2/10 catalog. So, so far there have been close to 800 different star catalogs used historically and into the present day, with the catalogs from the European Space Agency's Gaia mission being the largest to date, containing almost 1.7 billion stars. But that's a story for another time.
Right on. Good stuff. That is, yeah, there's so many things like this that honestly I would never have bothered to learn if it weren't for the fact that I was an elite commander. And that's one thing that I love about elite is that it can instill upon you or in you the desire to actually go out and learn some science. That's some real shit. And down to earth astronomy in the chat. This is also why we have rows of stars in Elite. That is absolutely correct. Talking about the different movements. And,
mm-hmm. Yeah, because as viewed from Earth, they sometimes couldn't get the distance to within less than a light year from Earth, and then they end up
guesstimating,
appearing in planes. We all are rounding. I don't know. They end up appearing in planes or walls of stars all grouped together.
Absolutely.
And you can see it in the game.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Good point.
So that takes us to Roy's stories.
We now return to our Inara Commander series with Mac Winston, Season 2, Episode 7, Shindig. Lagerkvist Gateway, Sintani. Finally, the time had come. The big ascension ceremony held at Zemina Torval's home station in Sintani. These ceremonies were held usually a couple of times a year, and those who had somehow distinguished themselves in service to the Empire were invited along. Therefore, it was a bit of a surprise that we were invited. Sure, I had reached the Imperial rank of Baron through service to the East India Company, and this was, of course, the reason for our invite, but that's only because they paid me. Ranks came with the rations, as it were. I also had to admit that perhaps I hadn't been the best captain in the East India Company, and we'd become noteworthy, not so much for our successes, but for one or two of our bizarre failures. Like the incident that ended up with fish raining down on that godforsaken planetary base that one time. But here we were, entering the grand ballroom, dressed immaculately in hand-tailored suits. The whole process had been a bit bizarre. First, getting the hand-tailored suit, not tat bought online, Cal had admonished me. There was a tailor in the hab ring on Harvestport. It had been like stepping back into the 17th century, only betrayed by a lone datapad that lay unused on the counter. The wizened old tailor had fussed around me, and then a week later I'd gone to pick up the new suit, at very great expense. Cal told me I looked almost as sexy as Denton Petraeus. Damnation with faint praise indeed. I decided I would get him back later for that remark. The ceremony itself was pretty much as I imagined. The first half was dominated by self-important windbags making worthy speeches. It was amusing to look around the gathered company. The assembled imperial hierarchy all had expertly managed to wear a face that exuded interest while managing to actually be half asleep at the same time. I glanced over at Cal. Yep. He had the look down. After all, being a native Akinarian, he had probably endured these events dozens of times. The other delegates, like me, who didn't have a lifetime of practice listening to boring speeches, well, the yawns and glazed-over eyes said it all. But no one seemed to notice. Amongst the assembled bigwigs and upper-end dignitaries was the lady herself, the fearsome Zemina Torval. Her penetrating gaze scythed across the assembly. I made sure to look interested in the speech when it was her turn. The second half was a lot more interesting, and, well, we very nearly caused another incident. First came the food and drink. No expense had been spared, and we mingled with the Empire's richest, naturally with the best quality food and drink. It wasn't long until Cal and I were starting to get a bit drunk on the rather excellent wine. These events were, so I was told beforehand, a good opportunity to network, rub shoulders with those who'll give us lucrative work. Make the most of it, George Oppenheimer had reminded us back on Harvestport before we left. And so we were. I let Cal do the talking. He was, after all, from a disgustingly wealthy family in Ekinar, and knew how to smooth talk these guys. Unexpectedly, it became my turn to make an introduction. I had been just picking yet another sample of the rather excellent sushi on offer when...
Commander Mac Winston, I've been looking forward to meeting you.
The source of the greeting was a rather imposing man of considerable size, wearing what was obviously an impressively expensive hand-tailored suit made on the Imperial homeworld. Impressively expensive, but not at all overstated or gaudy. His voice was deep and booming to match his voluminous chest.
Admiral Darius Hendrickson,
he introduced himself. I wasn't sure what I had done to get the notice of an Imperial Admiral. Pleased to meet you, I said. This is Callum Vaz... I looked around for Cal. He'd been there seconds before. He had disappeared. Kez. I'm sorry, he must have slipped off. Well, pleased to meet you anyway. And we shook hands.
I knew your great-uncle, James Winston, very well. I was very saddened to hear of his untimely death. We met a few times at flight training conferences. I used to be the chief instructor for the Internal Security Service, at the same time that your great uncle was running the Flight Academy at Dublin Citadel.
Well, that was a bit before my time, I'm afraid. But James Winston was Alliance, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. But we are not nearly as antagonistic as the media would have you believe.
Hendrickson replied slightly wistfully.
There were often conferences where we would meet up, and we struck up a good friendship despite our ideological differences. I was invited to your great uncle's home on a few occasions for a private meal. I met your father, too, when he was just a lad.
I had a sudden flash of curiosity. I never knew my father, apart from very vague images from my very early childhood. You met my father? What was he like?
Oh, very quiet. A studious lad, and, well, to be honest, a bit moody. He wanted to join the Alliance Science Council and become a pilot in the Exploration Wing. This was back in the days when we didn't have the modern friendship drive, and it took serious dedication to get anywhere. It's a tragedy that Norman Mosser got to him.
Hendrickson said, shaking his head sadly. I don't know much about my father's history. Well, except where he's mentioned a couple of times in the book, The Greatest Crimes of Norman Mosser by Phyllis Braun. I have his journals, but they're encrypted, and, well, I have the key, but it's protected by a passphrase, and I don't know it.
Well, maybe I can help you find what you're looking for. There's a mutual friend of ours who retired to XVA, and your great-uncle James had entrusted a significant amount of family data to his company. It might at least give you some pointers. I'll send him a message. He'll be willing to meet with you if I tell him that I met with you. He's become somewhat reclusive in his later years. You also might want to try Pan Gilmore, if she's still alive. She was your great-uncle's partner for many years, although I gather she had a somewhat strained relationship with your father.
Thank you. That would be greatly appreciated. I noticed another man approaching us. I thought he looked a bit like Callum. Could it be?
Good evening, Admiral. I trust you are enjoying the ceremony,
he asked as he glided by.
Splendid evening. You have once again excelled with the catering. May I introduce the delegate from the East India Company, Commander Mac Winston?
Enrique Vasquez. Very pleased to meet you,
he said rather formally. That's why he looked like Callum. He must have been his brother. May I also compliment you on the evening? Absolutely top quality, I replied smoothly. And by the way, I think I might know your brother. Enrique scowled just for a few milliseconds, but it was enough to warn me not to mention that Cal was actually here. Well, here somewhere.
How very unfortunate.
Enrique remarked acidly.
Before you think of doing business with him, I suggest you ask him why he was forced to leave the family home.
He briefly fixed me with a penetrating stare, then turned on his heel and disappeared back into the party. I looked over at Hendrickson. Oops, I said weakly.
Don't worry about Enrique. What his brother did was deeply shameful, but...
The Admiral briefly looked up at the ceiling.
If I had a family like his, the temptation would be awfully strong to do the same.
We spent the next few minutes talking of trivialities, such as my own brief potted history as a foster child on Azaban, and my eventual escape from that awful planet, until the inevitable call of nature crept up on me. I excused myself and scanned the room for Cal as I went towards the washroom. I had to warn him that his brother had laid on the arrangements. The last thing I wanted was there to be some kind of altercation. Deputy Oppenheimer had warned us in no uncertain terms that there would be consequences if we caused any incidents that brought the EIC into disrepute. A fistfight between the organizer and his brother would, I reflected, be such an incident. I entered the rather plush lavatory by myself. I was therefore rather surprised to hear a hoarse whisper from one of the cubicles.
Mac!
Came the urgent whisper. I turned around. Cal was peeping around the corner of a cubicle door. It seemed a bit comical as he beckoned me, half panicked.
What?
I asked in a normal voice.
I saw your brother here.
Suddenly, Cal grabbed me by the wrist and dragged me into the cubicle and shut the door.
Hey!
Shh!
I heard the washroom door open. I could hear two pairs of feet, and then the sound of a tap running. A sigh, and someone washing their hands.
Murdoch, I think my brother might be here with that pilot from the East India Company.
Came the voice. It was Enrique.
Yes, sir.
We are going to look for him. And if we find him, we will have them both ejected. Very publicly, of course.
Yes, sir.
And then I'm going to write a protest, in the strongest of terms, to the East India Company, employing such a vile weasel of a man.
Spat Enrique with surprising anger. We stood, perched slightly ridiculously on the lid of the toilet, listening to this going on outside. With relief, we heard the two pairs of feet again as Enrique and Murdoch left the washroom. I looked at Cal.
You know, you're going to tell me your life story on the way home. No more putting it off, I hissed at him.
You've got to get me out of here,
Cal pleaded.
Well, I can hardly just disappear with you now, can I? Enrique's going to be watching me like a hawk. You'll just have to lock yourself in here till it's all over.
Don't you think he'll look in here? I'm surprised he didn't already,
Cal hissed, panic in his voice.
Okay, I just met up with Admiral Hendrickson. He hinted that he's not really a fan of your family, and, well, it turns out he used to hobnob with my great-uncle. I'll see what I can do.
Great. I'd have to already use up a favor with this guy I barely knew and a high-up in the Empire, the sort of person I desperately needed to impress if I wanted to keep bringing in the trade. It seemed to take an agonizing amount of time before I could get to Admiral Hendrickson alone. I kept catching glimpses of Enrique, whose beady eyes always seemed fixed in my direction. He had me at a disadvantage. I didn't know who Murdoch was, but he'd obviously be looking out for me, too. Admiral, I started out, I have a bit of a problem. Hendrickson fixed me with a knowing smile.
He's here, isn't he?
Yeah, I said, looking around shiftily, hiding in the washroom. We just had a rather awkward chat standing on the toilet seat, while Enrique was outside discussing with some guy called Murdoch about having us publicly thrown out.
Murdoch is his personal slave, I think.
Yeah, anyway, it won't go down very well back in Harvestport. I could really do with some help. Hendrickson waved at someone, sliding out of the background, almost like a magical summoning. Appeared the most glamorous woman I had ever seen.
Melinda, please keep Murdoch occupied for a few minutes.
With pleasure,
she said smoothly and melted back into the crowd.
My personal assistant,
Hendrickson explained.
I trust her with my life,
he said with a wink.
And now I will go keep Enrique occupied. It won't be hard. There's an exit not 10 meters from the washroom. I suggest you let Callum slip out through there.
Hendrickson moved off towards Enrique. I made a point of not suddenly disappearing off to the washroom, instead availing myself to another glass of wine and making the motions as if I were about to talk to someone. Taking a few glances around the room, I noted that Hendrickson had engaged Enrique in conversation and had got him looking the other way. A couple of minutes later, I pushed Callum out the exit, unseen. I remained at the ceremony until the bitter end, so as not to draw any suspicion, hoping that Enrique Vasquez had finally become convinced that his brother wasn't actually there, after all. Finally, relief. Perhaps we had dodged this particular bullet. Cal would have a lot of explaining to do when I got back to the ship. A lot of explaining.
Cal, you got some explaining to do. All right, let's see what happens next with Mac and his boyfriend. Woo! Okay. next up, we've got a video from Cyberblitz, and I'm going to share it with you. I spacewalked in a station. That's right, boys and girls. Thanks to the lovely bugs that come to us with Odyssey Alpha, we've got EVAs in Elite Dangerous, and I'm a huge, huge fan. Tell me what you think of this. That's right. Ground control to that guy floating in the middle of a station. Watch out, here comes a dolphin duck. Yeah, man. Good stuff. Yeah, this was literally a guy. He's like, I went to pay off a fine at the lawyers, the Interstellar Factors, and I clicked on the thing to pay the fine, and next thing I know, literally the screen went black, and then it flashed, and I was sitting in the very middle of I was just floating. And he's like, it's weird, because unlike everybody else's stories of they couldn't do anything, he's like, I was able to pull out my gun and shoot and do all kinds of stuff. So if you see on there, he's racking up fines. He's just shooting at ships going by and getting fines. He was like, I don't know, whatever. We're going to have some fun with this shit. And I salute that. That was some cool and weird and super, super funny shit. You guys got any? Look at that. He's scanning. He's like, I got my scanner. I'm waiting for somebody with a bounty coming by. I'm going to cut somebody with this arc torch. Let's do it. Anybody got anything?
Well, just that looks like a whole lot more interesting than the people that fell through the elevators. Like, he's getting to do stuff there, and it certainly holds out hope that there's nothing, I don't know, something else is preventing them from letting us do EVAs at the moment, I guess.
For sure. The one thing that he couldn't do is it would not let him, it wouldn't let him use his little jump pack or whatever. He couldn't aim, but he could turn around. He just couldn't sort of control his movement. Wolf.
He should have gotten a bounty to see if the station lasers would have nuked him.
He did. He was firing at stuff and doing all kinds of stuff. He was getting fines, but he couldn't kill anything, so he couldn't actually get a bounty. Like, he could just get fines.
They probably couldn't target him.
Yeah. That would be interesting. All right, so that takes us to the next bit, which is a lovely video by Scott. No, so for Cyberblitz, the video that we just showed you that you see on the screen now, and for this one that you're about to see from Cyberblitz, Jesus Christ, how many times am I going to click on the wrong thing? Asset 7. This one that you're about to see on the screen, we're going to just talk for a little while. Both of these are in the show notes. Go and check them out. You should go and subscribe to Cyberblitz and subscribe to Scott Gust. He made a phenomenal video called Odyssey Alpha Phase 2, The Most Insanely Beautiful World I Have Experienced. It's a 14 and a half minute long video, so we're going to just play it with the sound down in the background while we talk about the Odyssey Alpha Week 3 experience, Phase 3, whatever, experience. right off the bat, I'm going to run through super, super fast. Yes, you guys enjoying that on the screen? For sure, go subscribe. This guy is worth it. I'm going to run through the list of stuff that is like, hey, this is still ongoing stuff that they haven't addressed yet. I want an answer to it. Number one, where's our UI stream dev team stream from last week? Number two, from 2 weeks ago, Elite needs an unstuck button like every MMO for the last decade has had. You, for stuff like they're stuck floating in the stream, and literally their option is, I could turn on the battery and that'll run, I could turn on my flashlight, that'll run down my battery quicker, and then I'll hopefully die. Like, yes, Elite needs an unstuck button. Always has, always will. Scavenging still seems gutted. They haven't responded. I've asked them and said, hey, this seems gutted. Do you guys, just tell me that you're planning to put more, because it seems gutted now. Haven't got any answer yet. The copy pasta stations, we showed you the video earlier. It's fucking Instagram filters. There's no difference. Needs to be addressed. The UI is still in flux. There's a lot of stuff. I called out last week. Dude, I am super excited by some of the UI stuff that I'm seeing. And then I've seen a mountain of salt from people over the week of like, the UI sucks. And you know what? Both are true. There's actually a lot in there to love, but there's a lot that is jank. And it would have been way better if they had actually finished the UI as a product and then given it to us to test. What they did was they gave it to us half done. So with all of our complaints on the UI, it's sort of unclear. Are we complaining about stuff that's bad or just not finished yet? You know, for example, in the ship outfitting thing, there's a button. You click on it as soon as you get to your ship and it says loadout. When I saw loadout on the ships, I had a massive erection. I was like, yes, please. Let us save loadouts for our modules on our ships. That would be amazing. I've wanted that for forever. Yeah, no, the button doesn't do anything. It doesn't go anywhere. I hope that that's going to be a thing. Did they manage to put it there? I hope that they're going to use it. Maybe it's just not done yet? Question mark? So yeah, like it's very obvious that they're like scrambling like hell to finish bits of this hours before they give it to us to play with. And it's like some of it, like the UI, they didn't bother to finish it. They just said, well, fuck it. Go test it. It's not done yet, guys. How about you finish baking your loaf of bread before you give it to me to taste test? The mini, like, come on, a 3-second cutscene climbing up the ladder when you board the ship. 3 seconds. That's all I need. You had it for the SRV. You had it for the SLFs. Put it in for on foot. Failing mission on death, even post success. That's still sort of unaddressed. Let's get into that. No real stealth mechanics, despite the fact that they said stealth mechanics would be key. We talked about it last week in detail. Let's get into that. Hacking. It's completely missing. They have e-breachers now, but nothing about hacking. And it's starting to make me wonder, like, did they just decide, hey, we're going to skip hacking. And what we'll say is, hacking is you aim the scanner gun at somebody and you spoof their ID. Like, that's hacking. Ta-da! Finished. Instead of hacking as a minigame. I don't know. The tutorial. It's not there. Hasn't been mentioned. I don't know. Beefed up instancing, player group enabling. That was a huge thing that was discussed sort of early on and hasn't been discussed at all for months. Please, for the love of God, tell me, with all this stuff you put in here for people to do together, that you beefed up instancing or group play enabling with the Amazon Web Server architecture or something. CQC FPS. Art said a long, long time ago on stream, yes, we have CQC FPS. Haven't heard it mentioned everywhere, anywhere at all since. The grindception, the double grinding minimum for all suits and guns, level 1 through 5 to modify it, and then level 1 through 5 to engineer it. I put up a poll on the YouTube channel on the community for this YouTube channel, and I put it up earlier today, and the last time I looked, it was like 90% people are saying, this is not okay. I'm not happy with this. This needs to change. I put up 3 options. I put up, yeah, I like it. It's given us something to do. I put up like, I'm not thrilled about it, but like, it's not going to be that bad. And I put up like, no, fuck no. This needs to get fixed. And like 90% of the people are saying, this needs to get fixed. Let's see. Stepping away from the strong scientific and lore consistent basis of the game, as in, 0G outpost. I've mentioned it on every stream. They do not engage. They do not respond. 0G movement looking, 0.01G movement looking the exact same as 1G. They don't respond. They don't, whatever. No sign of atmospheric entry. I cannot tell you how easy that would be to code of from the, like, literally, you put up a little flash right as you re-enter, as you cross the atmospheric barrier, you put up a flash of fire across your screen, and you shake the ship a little. Ta-da! Like, yes, granted, I'm a stupid fucking Marine. I'm not a coder, but they can put a little fire graphic on the screen for 3 to 5 seconds while they rattle the ship. They could do that in 1981 on the fucking Buck Rogers show. They can do that in this game in 2021. Let's see. And space cowboys. People running around on fucking planets with no air. Because...
with no helmets.
They're wearing cowboy hats. Because...
yeah.
What? And then the last one I'm throwing it in just for... I know this was an ode to us in Odyssey, but we all wanted it, and I think we still want it. Crossplay. Come on, guys. Come on. Let's get it together. Crossplay. Now, having said that, that's my real quick down and dirty, and I'm going to keep mentioning this until Odyssey's done, like Alpha's done, and they launch, or until somebody gives us answers to this. Is there anything I missed that you guys are like, yeah, this is on my list, and you didn't mention it? Just feel free to step in. Who wants to go?
I have a few, but I don't know if they fall into the category of working as intended or something's broke.
Hit them.
I mean, the one that I think is working as intended, and it's sort of a carryover from last week. I mean, on last week's show, we'd only had a short amount of time to play with some of the new features in the new phase. I'm still not sold on the whole switching weapons thing to go through shield and then body. I played a lot of frontline developments in the last week, and that piece of the mechanism, I mean, I get it. They've explained why it is. I'm just not sure that it's fun. And I think a big change is going to be when we obviously get to play with plasma weapons. But then does that just mean that everyone's going to play with plasma weapons and it effectively shrinks the pool of weapons that are anywhere useful? That's one thing that kind of... I was having a lot of fun with frontline developments, and that kind of started dragging me down. Like, this is just...
yeah. You know, every time you say frontline developments, I'm picturing David Braben with a headband going, you know, yippee-ki-yay, motherfucker. Yeah, frontline solutions. But yes,
sorry,
you're putting frontline solutions and frontier developments together.
Before that, I kept saying frontier solutions, so I mashed it up a different way this time. But yes,
beautiful. Right on.
That's one. I we'll get to some of my other stuff about exploration. But that, as far as the combat one, that's the one that was kind of getting me down.
Wolf?
I've got nothing that you guys haven't covered, to be honest.
Oh, okay. Okay. I saw you had a dot on there, so I thought, okay, that was on something else. All right. So now let's just get to the sort of open discussion. Phase 3, exploration suit. Phase 3 brought us the exploration suit, the biosampler gameplay, Vista Genomics, First Footfall, and it was already hot fixed. One day in to the plant gun, and people were like, it's too hard. We need to nerf this. It's Twitch gameplay. And you know what? I get it. I get it. I'll say this with regard to the plant gun gameplay loop. First off, here's the trick. Here's the hint. I'll give you the hint on how to do it. Ignore all the little dots. Look for the largest bar on each go around, and just line up the largest bar, and know that unlike with the subsurface deposit mining where you have to cheat it like a half a second early for it to slide into the right spot, with the bar you have to cheat it a half a second late. I don't know why, but that's the way it is, and you have to do it that way. I tried it the first time and I was like, okay, And then I looked at it and it's like, let's break this down. Ignore everything but the largest bar. Do it a quarter to a half a second late. Just slide it on the late side. And I was getting it like 90% of the time. It's not that hard. I will say this. The hot fix that they put in today at noon already made it way, 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 way easier to do. I will say, while it wasn't that hard for me, like I broke it down and figured out how to overcome it, how to do it. I will say that it's kind of dumb to have a Twitch-based sort of, like, everything in Elite Dangerous is, well, most everything in Elite Dangerous is, like, aimed at more of your sort of HOTAS forum dads. You know, it's more the intellectual, it's more the thought and the planning and how you execute, as opposed to just Twitch. It's not like a, you know, like a Twitch-based game. That's not what Elite is or wasn't until Odyssey dropped or came to Alpha. So I completely understand and respect all the people that say, I do not like this. I came for a different kind of game. What are you doing? And I get that. It didn't seem that hard for me, but that's just, I broke down how to do it. And then once I figured it out, it was like, oh, this isn't that bad. But having said that, there was no intellect. There was no planning. There was no thought. It was just, can you line up a Twitch bar? Oof, that's a little whatever. And then when you finally successfully scan the plant, when I was excited last week when we saw the snippet ahead of time where it's like, okay, you do this, and then the game crashed, and I was like, okay. But afterwards, when you successfully collect a sample, it's going to, you know, show you data on the plant. It's going to show you. I was like excited for what comes next. Nothing comes next. You successfully scan the thing, and it gives you no scientific data on the plant. It gives you no nothing. Hello Games, that's fucking, what, 14 people, 20 people? They, in No Man's Sky, when you scan the plants, it gives you, like, a little scientific screen that pops up that says, this plant has these useful materials. Now, yeah, it's not science. It's just sort of, you can get this. You can use it for crafting that. But, like, Hello Games did a better job than Frontier on having some, even if it's just pseudoscience, some, you scan the plant and there's something to it, some depth. Frontier went with, hey, we're a shooter now, so we're going to make a Twitch-based plant shooter game. And that to me was just like, oh, that's a super, super bummer. And also with regard to sort of that whole mini game. In Art's video on everything you need to know about the genomics or whatever, biosampling, he was like, we have four times as many plants now as we had before. You guys all saw that video we just played a little bit ago of David Braben, you know, talking about what you can do with procedural generation and how you can make, you know, thousands and millions and whatever of a thing. And he showed specifically, he was like, here is Joshua Tree and the biome there. And then here is this, you know, place in England that has like these redwoods and whatever, these types of plants. And look at how whatever, so diverse, so amazing. And Frontier, like I dig that it's more, and I dig that it's colorful, and I think the plants look very cool the way they're sort of out there, whatever. But like, if you come to a big pod of a big area and it's like, there are these four plants. Okay. Four plants. Roy, and then Tweaked. Go ahead.
Yeah, a couple quick points. One, just to thread on the thing about, you know, four more or four times more or whatever. I think they missed a trick when they, I like that they've got pods of things where there's multiple things in them. If they really wanted to exercise the procedural generation, maybe they could have the wonder of finding, you know, if you find this, I don't even know the names of these new things, but you find this thing, and if it's on its own, it's this. If it happens to be with something else, now there's a chance for a hybrid, which could be a rare version of it, you know, because it's appearing with these other three things. But the other thing I wanted to say was more about the mini game. When I first saw the mini game, I thought, oh, that looks kind of cool, fun, whatever. After trying it like 20 times, I'm fine with it. I can get it done. But what occurred to me is, I think the reason it feels sort of like a waste of time is because it doesn't affect the outcome. it doesn't give you a chance to get something better for doing it well. Like if you compare it to the subsurface mining, like you brought up, if you pick the right blue chunks in subsurface mining, you get more stuff. It like rewards your skill and your time, because sometimes you got to wait for the single column blue thing to come along instead of just picking the first one that's four blocks wide in the subsurface mining. There's a reward for time spent. There's a reward for skill done. Yeah, as far as it being a Twitch thing, so I got two examples. One is in Warframe, when you're mining on foot, let's not get down that rabbit hole, but when you're mining on foot, the mini game they have has you kind of trace a weird shape, and the better you do it, the better the yield, and sometimes you can get rare stuff by doing it perfect. Mm. Like something like that, where skill, even if it is a physical Twitch skill you build up, it has some outcome other than just wasting time until you get the same darn thing as if you had done it perfect the first time. And the second example I'd have is there's lots of games that have lock picking challenges. And that to me is a more sort of cerebral, you don't have to go fast, you just have to be accurate. And that might have been a better path to take than something that's like super, like moving quickly and having to hit a certain thing in time. It would fit more with the exploration loop if it was a more of a cerebral puzzle kind of thing versus just a quick twitchy thing.
Yeah, right on. Tweet?
I can totally agree with everything Roy just said there, Roy. That was perfect. I would just like to add a simple statement, though. I've heard everybody complaining about this today. And prior to this, I heard a lot of complaining about no mini game with the scavenging, no mini game with breaking into the settlements or anything like that, no mini game with this. And now here's a mini game, and oh no, it's too hard. It's too hard.
It's not too hard, really.
There's no whining in Elite, guys. Come on. We can figure this stuff out.
A, it's not too hard. And B, it's definitely not too hard now because they nerfed it one day in. It is easy now. It's, to me, it's not that it's too hard. It never was too hard. To me, it was too brainless.
Yeah, to me, it looked a lot to me like, I can't remember exactly what it was. Maybe it was the mini game in Mass Effect to unlock the meta gel or something like that, if I remember correctly, back in the day. And at first it was a little bit challenging, then it got really easy, and then by the end of the game it was just kind of a nuisance to have to go through it every time. I can see that happening with this. All in all, with the exobiology that I've watched last night and today, it looks interesting. It looks like some cool things to possibly see. It doesn't look like a game loop that's going to keep me engaged long term, though.
Yeah. So I had a thought. What if you, because we had all those schematics and stuff, what if you had to collect a bunch of vehicle schematics to unlock SRV variants? As much as I don't like grind, I mean, if you give me new SRVs, fuck it, I'll do it. Like, what do you guys, you know, what do you think?
I'm all in favor of more options and more choice. Even if, you know, it's like the discussion we had previously about ships, even if it's a side grade, it's all good. And it rewards the grind with better stuff, not just a grind to burn time.
Mm. Okay. So I tested some of the maps out with regard to the functionality in the alpha. And I got to say, it's a mixed bag. Some of it is very, very cool. There's some neat stuff there. Some of it is super, super janky and feels like it's not done. And I have to confirm, sadly, that there are no extra folders that are player controlled in there. I got excited because I saw folders, and there are folders, but it's Frontier breaking out saying, these locations are planets, these locations are settlements, these locations are star systems, like that. And it's like, seriously, guys, for the love of Christ, I've interviewed every community manager that they've had for like the last fucking 2 years. And every last one of them I've brought up and said, hey, when are we going to get player controlled map, you know, bookmark folders and all that stuff? And every last one of them said, you know, that's a really good point. I'm going to take it back to the company and we're going to look into that. And every last one of them have done fuck all with it. I'm tired of asking nicely. Give us fucking map. Bookmark folders that we can control. Enough already. Just do it. Okay. I tested the CZ. The drop sequence was super cool. The FPS play was FPS play. Meh. Okay. Upgrading the guns seems to help a little bit to mitigate the sort of needing to swap back between one type to another type. If you upgrade your gun to like level 2 or 3, you can kill a guy with a main weapon with a full clip. Like, that doesn't really address it, but like if you buff your DPS enough through just upgrading your stuff, it kind of halfway does. It's still a little lame to me, but it's like, all right, it's something at least. And I need to clarify something that we said before. There is no stun in the game. We thought that there was because you could use your energy link to shoot someone, but Frontier changed it from what it was, which was your energy link would knock a guy out. And because of the PEGI rating, they were like, well, no, we're just going to make it to where you kill a guy, but without a gunshot sound. So it's more of a silent, deadly. It's like basically the equivalent of stabbing a guy in the back of the neck with a, you know, with a knife. You're just electrocuting him to death. We gave you a suggestion a month ago saying, if you put out a free DLC on every platform, on Steam, on Epic, on everywhere, put out a free DLC, but you age gate that DLC to say you have to be 18 years or older to buy it, and you buy it, and then it says, yes, now let me have the full, you know, play, the full everything. And people that don't click on that, they would get segregated out to a fucking kiddie pool. But let's be honest, we're all 18 or above, and even the 15-year-olds are going to click on that because nobody sets up their parental bullshit. So, yeah, then we will be able to have stunning in the game. We would be able to have cool things that you could do where you didn't have to just murder everybody. I think that would be better. I think that would be more meaningful. And here we go. Tweaked? Oh, no, Roy. Tweaked was on the last thing.
Just a quick comment about the CZs. I tried using an SLF in one of the CZs, and
can't target. Interestingly,
interestingly, you can choose a side.
Uh-huh.
It sort of highlights this whole thing of if you're gonna go in a combined arms way, how are you supposed to communicate tactics between the person on foot, the person in the SRV, a person in an SLF, and certainly a person in a ship. Like we were reduced to trying to say to the person, because they couldn't see any designators, not just even to be able to target people, but the people you could see, there was no green dot or red dot. You didn't know who was in, and they all looked the same. Mm-hmm. So there was no way to tell who was who, to tell who to shoot at, even though you couldn't target them. And so we were reduced to like, well, there's some guys on that bridge. And that was literally saying there's some guys on that. So we couldn't even point to which bridge it was.
Mm-hmm.
It was super clunky trying to coordinate any kind of close air support. I mean, there's all kinds of obvious solutions from other games, being able to laser designate something or throw some smoke or even target people. And then there's now they're going to be designated or somehow, but we have none of those mechanisms in place. So I'm just curious what their vision was of people sort of playing together in different modes. Is it just everybody goes in and shoots everything, or like, are we not going to have anything more sophisticated than that? Like what are we not seeing here?
All right. My last point, while I've been doing a little bit of the alpha, I've also been having some fun with a little side project in the base game, and that is this. I was watching both seasons of The Mandalorian, and I was, you know, I had that going on the second screen, and I engineered up a cool little courier ship that I'm going to use as my taxi when Odyssey drops for realsies. I called it the Razor Crest because I've been, you know, knee deep into The Mandalorian, and I got it set up for, you know, doing fun stuff out there. And I feel like, you know, I'm trying to put a good face on it and trying to figure out how I'm gonna have my fun. I'm seeing a comment in the chat saying the sphere of combat was a bold lie. Sort of, I feel like, maybe. I mean, from what I've seen thus far, I can't argue with you. It is still alpha. Maybe. And also, it's not just alpha. Guys, let's be honest. This isn't a regular alpha. This is an alpha where they are working programming Monday night the shit that they're going to release to us on Tuesday. Like, this is not even... I feel like if they take this back from us, you know, if this ends around April 30th, I mean, not that it's going to because they said it's not, but like, yeah, it is. If it ends around April 30th and they take this back for like 60 days... and they spit out a product that has like actual serious, a lot, like 2 more months of hardcore work into it, there's a really good chance we could end up with a decent product. It's just what we're seeing. It's like they gave us a car to test, a quality test, and like they haven't put all the pieces on it yet. So it seems like dog shit now. It might be that it's going to be good. But we can only judge what we see, and what we see isn't great. Tweaked?
Yeah, on top of that, I just watching the video that was just playing, and you had the Cobra flying around the ice world with the blue skies and the sunshine, I've yet to see anything that looks even remotely close to that in any of the streams. Everything's fairly dark with a little bit of a sunshine haze over the horizon, yeah. And I'm waiting to see that awe-inspiring shot like we're on Hoth and it's daytime or something, and I'm wondering if that's missing from the alpha, or was that a lie too? Or I really hope, like you say, if they got a few months to go build this up again before the release, I'm hoping that we get a great product, because what I see is a good base, but it needs a lot of trimming. It needs a lot of extra trimmings in it in order to make it what we want it to be.
And for the love of Christ, get away from the fucking looter shooter FPS dude bro side and go back towards your... Now, you have some of that. That's fine. But go back to your base of science. Go back to your base of fucking nerds that want science, that want something believable, that want... I want NASA. I don't want... Me personally... I want NASA. Like, yes, okay, you got some Star Wars in there. That's fine, whatever. But I want NASA. All right, Roy, we are running super late on time, so take 5 minutes and run through. We're going to not even interrupt you. Run through your observations, and then sure. Yeah.
Yeah, so I was, as I've said before, exploration's a big loop for me, so I was really diving into some of this. Here's some of my quick observations in... and searching for biologicals, I've spent literally months in the black doing that. Super Cruise surface scanner, when you're orbiting in this heat map thing that you can see now and showing you the biologicals, I mean, the first thing I thought of is that's not colorblind friendly. Anything that's using, is this maybe the first thing they've had in game where people have to distinguish based on color, something about what they're going to do next? Maybe. That's a bit of a problem. The other thing I noticed was now we don't have to land on a planet to figure out which biologicals are on the planet. That's a huge shift from how we did bio POIs before. You had to land, and there was the whole thing with even with the Canon EDMC plugin, you know, go to this body and please check out these 5 bios. Like, that's a huge difference. I'm not sure if it's good or bad. Biologicals are now separated from points of interest. Again, that's a huge shift. Totally changes the paradigm about how we search for biologicals. One thing I noticed was if you do find something on the heat map you want to go look at, it's difficult to track it down to the surface. I felt like I don't want to think that they were being disingenuous on the stream, but as they were going, they, you know, Art found something he wanted to fly towards. As they were going down to the surface, he kind of like made a motion like, oh, I'm going to switch out of analysis mode. The truth is that thing turns off whether you want it to or not. And now you're sort of flying blind down to the surface with no indication of where was that hotspot I was flying towards. And it gets very disorienting as you get down to the surface. And when you get on the surface, there's nowhere to reference that. You don't have like a gauge on your plant tool that's giving you like a percent strength, or like you're kind of lost. I had to go back into orbit a few times and then come back down again to try to figure out, well, where was that thing I thought I was flying towards? So there's a bit of a gap there. First footfall, it's called visited by in the system map, not first footfall, kind of weird. But also it doesn't show up in the FSS or the orbital surface scanner where you normally see discovered by and mapped by, you don't see visited by. For some reason, it's only in the system map, so I'm not sure if that's working as intended. I noticed when you're walking through the pods of all the biologicals in a group, some of them look like they ought to be like waving in whatever tenuous atmosphere is there, but as far as I could tell, many of them are modeled as if they're as solid as a rock. So that's a thing. Like, I'd love to be able to sort of browse through them as if it was a little bit of a forest and not have to keep jumping over it because I'm getting stuck on all the geometry. Kind of a big deal too. The biosites I saw, they don't drop any materials. You know, that's obviously something that people went to biological sites for, certain ones in particular, in the live game right now. So I'm not sure what's going to happen there. There was a comment actually came from one of the Burr Pit when they did their analysis of, and they pointed out that it's this whole thing of you're burning a sample if you switch plants, and if you find a pod of stuff that has three things in it, you've literally got to trace out a triangle three times to get three different things because you can't just do more than one. And an idea I had there is maybe there could be an upgrade for the plant gun that makes it more like a refinery that has more bins as you upgrade it so you can hold more than one partial sample.
God,
just
please.
Saying that's an unfun loop if they don't allow some upgrade path there. There was one biological I found. It was like a bacteria of some kind. So it was like flat on the ground versus all these other ones that are like trees and bushes and things. I accidentally found it. I was driving along. The SRV's composition scanner happened to be active, and it kind of blipped. And what I noticed was, if you're trying to do some kind of combined thing with SRV and walking, the SRV scanner no longer registers these new biologicals. Before, it would show you stuff on the scanner that would kind of lead you to things. Now it's just blank. So I'm not sure, again, if that's an accident or that's working as intended, but it certainly makes it difficult to use an SRV to complement what you're doing. The only kind of solution I could find was driving around with the turret up and the comp scanner armed and kind of painting over the horizon to the front of the ship, or the front of the SRV, sort of up and down, and like as if I was painting the whole landscape with the comp scanner, doing a manual scan across all the pixels to see when it would light up.
Yeah.
Super goofy, super jank. Scanning on foot is pretty short range. As far as I can tell, it's about 45 to 50 meters. So that's not an issue for the stuff that you can see from a distance that looks like little trees, but however many of these things that are flat on the ground, super difficult. Not a problem if, and my next point is the payment for these things, if that's going to vary by rarity or difficulty of finding them, that would be good. If there's no correlation between those things, then that would kind of suck. And then there's just a grab bag of stuff that I think I'm going to have to wait till phase 4 to answer, because there's no way to test it with the limited bubble they've got us in. Like, are the things that we previously used as crystal shard sites, are those things like planetary wide now because they're not tied to a POI? There was a thing where biologicals of a certain type in the galaxy map would only spawn in certain galaxy regions. And it was pretty freaking obvious because you'd see on any map that showed where they'd been discovered, there was a hard stop at the boundaries of certain sectors, which was, that's immersion breaking and not cool. I don't know if that's been changed now and how the new Forge works. So I'm curious about that. Curious to see if the old brain tree versus guardian site relationship still holds. Used to be you could, if you found a brain tree, you knew there was a site within a certain distance. And also just generally, and I brought this up before, the old bio sites that have all been mapped across the galaxy to this point, are they now just sort of redistributed within those same planets according to a heat map? So it's just an sort of a planet by planet reshuffle geographically, or has there been a complete galaxy-wide re-roll of everything?
If the crystal forest sites are gone, someone is going to set fire to fucking Cambridge.
Well, there's sort of an underlying issue there of, I don't know that we ever knew that they weren't hand-placed. So that's another unknown as to whether or not that can be that can be the test article or not. But yeah, still a lot of questions. Waiting to phase 4 before I sort of pass judgment on exploration.
Tweaked, your observations. Go.
Well, observations, like I said, the exploration part, I'm not an explorer in the game as is. I've gone out in the black, I've done some exploring, but it's not my main interest in the game by far. This, again, like I said, it looks somewhat interesting. The mini game doesn't intimidate me at all. I'll get the hang of that once I finally get hands on with it. It's another thing to do. It's, you add it in with all the other things that we can do, and it gives us options. That's all I can really say about it right now. I would say, though, Roy, to your point about testing the shards, I have a spot that's in the bubble that you can get to that we could actually test that if you wanted to.
Oh, yeah. Tell me which one it is. Let's go test it.
Absolutely. We'll do that.
All right. Wolf, your observations. Then we're going to move on and wrap this up.
There's things that I like what I see. There's things that I don't like what I see. Granted, I haven't been able to spend pretty much any time in alpha, but we'll see what comes up.
Right on. And tell your wife hi. And why did somebody pull the wings off a butterfly? That seems weird. All right.
You caught as much of that conversation as I did.
Community questions. We got two for you tonight. First one, your thoughts on the entire alpha so far, as we're now in phase 3, and your thoughts on the Hesperus event. Write in and tell us what you thought of both of those, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I will say, and I know it sounded, because we're tight on time, it sounded like there was just a laundry list of complaints. I think Odyssey is exciting in that it provides a new canvas, a new extension, a new medium in which we can transpose our experiences in Elite. I am all for that. I am super excited by that. I just don't want them to ditch the thoughtfulness and the, don't ditch what brought you to the party and now chase after brainless FPS bullshit. Like, okay, if you want to have FPS to offer, okay, fine. That's fine. But the scavenging play, no thought behind it. It's very meh. And it's the exciting part of it is you get to shoot at people before you go scavenge. But then the actual scavenging is meh. The plant gameplay is Twitch-based and meh. And I don't mind that it's Twitch-based. I don't think that's a smart move for them to make with their audience, but it didn't bother me. I'm not here for 1 second complaining that it's too hard. I'm complaining that it's too shallow. I'm complaining that there was no thought, no science, no anything behind it. I love Elite. And even if Odyssey is absolute dog shit, I'm still going to happily play Elite and fly around and do all the fun stuff that I can in my ship. But I hope that it's not. I think there is a lot of room here for Odyssey to be awesome. And even if it's just so-so to start, so long as they make the right moves going forward and use this as a base to get back to the gameplay, the thoughtful, intelligent, more cerebral, more strategic, more tactical and thoughtful gameplay, this can be awesome, even if it's just meh at launch. There's a lot of things that was just meh at Elite launch, where the mining laser, whatever, and then later they added cores and it got more interesting, or they didn't have landing on any planets, and then they added stuff with Horizons. There's a lot that can come sort of to this to add and to make things better. So for people hearing us give the list of what we don't like, it's because right now they're saying, this is alpha. Give us what you don't like and give us, whatever. And we have listed plenty that we did like. So, I just want them to step it up some. And I honestly feel almost bad making my complaints. I feel like I feel like literally they didn't give them enough time to make the pizza, and they rushed it out half cooked, and now they're like, taste test the pizza. And I'm sorry, all I can say is this pizza tastes like dog shit. But it's not really the fault of the person who made the pizza as far as put together the ingredients. It's the fault of the person who didn't finish cooking it before they put it out there to be taste tested. So, like, I feel like, you know, I've said it before and I'll say it again. They hit a wall. They got delayed. And then now it's like, rush, rush, rush. Just put something out before end of year because we need that revenue. Okay. I think that's a choice. And I just hope that you make it better in the end. I hope that you make it right eventually. And yeah. I'm not going to give, let's not do state of the games this week because it's honestly,
it's in flux.
It's in flux. We don't know what the state is because it's not done cooking yet. So we're going to skip that. And we're going to go ahead and sign off. Say goodnight to the beautiful people, Roy.
Walk casual and stay dangerous.
Right on. Stay goodnight to the beautiful people, Wolf.
Thanks for joining us, everyone, and hope you have a great weekend.
Absolutely. Tweaked?
Good night, everybody. Thanks for spending a few hours with us. And remember, I think what we're seeing here is like it's the Christmas tree that just got put up and all the family comes over and says, oh, look at that. But it's not decorated yet. So I'm hoping once Odyssey gets all its decorations on, it's going to be absolutely fantastic. My fear is they've gotten lackadaisical. So let's stay positive. Let's have some hope and see what they do next. Nanu nanu, everybody. Have a good weekend.
Yes, yes, nanu nanu. And I'm going to say good night. I love you all. I'm going to throw out a line from my man, Dig That. Fly dirty, Commanders. And this is a song that goes out to all the space cowboys out there ignoring the fucking lack of oxygen.
Some people call me the space cowboy, yeah. Some call me the gangster of love. Some people call me Maurice, 'cause I speak of the pompousness of love. People talk about me, baby. Say I'm doing you wrong, doing you wrong. Well, don't you worry, baby, don't worry, 'cause I'm right here, right here, right here, right here at home. 'Cause I'm a picker, I'm a grinner, I'm a lover, and I'm a sinner. I play my music in the sun. I'm a joker, I'm a smoker, I'm a midnight toker. I give my lovin' on the run. Ooh.
'cause I'm right here at home. You're the cutest thing I ever did see. Really love your peaches, wanna shake your tree. Lovey-dovey, lovey-dovey, lovey-dovey all the time.